Grace and peace to you from our Lord Jesus Christ. I'd like to welcome all of you to our worship service here at Reveille United Methodist Church. We are glad that all of you are here with us in person, and we welcome all of you who are also with us online. My name is Stephen Coleman. I'm the associate pastor here at Reveille. Our lead pastor, the Reverend Dr. Pete Moon, is preaching this morning. We are continuing our sermon series on the big stories of the Bible, and today we will be hearing a story from the book of Daniel about the fiery furnace and the three men thrown in the furnace. And we will be learning about the importance of faith and deepening our faith and how our faith can impact our lives. Today is a very special Sunday. We also have a baptism this day, and we are celebrating a lot of new life in our church family. We have a cradle cross on our altar, which is for Hampton Van Der Veer, who was born on March 5th. And we also celebrate with the Brewer family, Charlie and Taylor Brewer, welcomed a new child in their life last week, Charles Brewer. So we celebrate and lift them up this day as well. Do draw your attention to your bulletin. You'll see a list of announcements and activities of what is going on in the life of our church. I do want to highlight a few things. Starting in August, we will just have one service at 11 a.m. here in our sanctuary. And you can also continue to watch the service online. And then on September 12th, our plan and our hope is to return to three worship services, an 8:30 service in our chapel, our 9:30 service in our fellowship hall, and of course our 11 a.m. service here in our sanctuary. We continue with our food drive for the food banks for our partner churches in Swansboro. You can continue to drop off canned goods in our Welcome Center. And then on August 1st, we will have a school supply drive to help those at Swansboro Elementary School. So pay attention for more details about that drive. We are glad that you are here with us, and let us now prepare our hearts and minds for the worship of the living God. The Lord be with you. I invite you to stand and join me now for our call to worship. But now, thus says the Lord, He who created you, O Jacob, He who formed you, O Israel,
fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through fire, you shall not be burned, and the flames shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. O worship the King. Our first hymn is hymn number 73, and I do remind you that we put on our mask as we sing together. If you do need a mask this morning, we have extra masks at our welcome table in the narthex. Let us sing together.
Worship the King, O glorious above, O gratefully sing God's power and God's love, our shield and defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned in splendor and girded with praise. Thy bountiful care what tongue can recite? It breathes in the air, it shines in the light. It streams from the hills, it descends to the plain, and sweetly distills in the dew and the rain. Frail children of dust and feeble as frail, in thee do we trust, nor find thee to fail. Thy mercies how tender, how firm to the end. Our Maker, Defender, Redeemer, and Friend.
Please join me in the prayer of common confession found in your bulletin. Let us pray. Gracious God, you are an all-consuming fire. But we confess that we fear the fiery furnace more than we fear you. All too easily, we compromise when we should stand firm. We kneel before the gods of this culture before we worship you. By your grace, give us a spirit of discernment, that we might know you and your will, and that we might hold fast to your refining presence. For we ask this in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. God's mercy is deep and wide. God's mercy is always calling us to repentance and ready to forgive. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. If our family is ready for baptism, brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift offered to us without price. I present Virginia Davis Powell for baptism.
And Blair and Davis, as you come and bring Virginia to the church for baptism, we have questions which we ask of you. And by answering these, not only do you indicate your faith in Christ, but also your desire to raise her in the faith. So now I invite you to hear these questions. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, respond by saying, I do. Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? Again, I do. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all nations, races, and ages? If so, respond by saying, I do. And will you nurture in Christ, this child in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example, she might be able to accept God's grace for herself, to profess her faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? If so, respond by saying, I will.
And do you, The people of Reveille United Methodist Church, do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ?
We do.
Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include this child now before you in your care?
With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround her with a community of love and forgiveness that she may grow in her service to others. We will pray for her that she may be a true disciple who walks in the way that leads to life.
Let us join together in professing the Christian faith as contained in the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father,
and will come again to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church,
the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Eternal Father, when nothing existed but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water. After the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you promised. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Tell of God's mercy each day. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all nations. Declare his works to the nations, his glory among all the people. Pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water and Virginia, who now receives it, to wash away her sin, to clothe her in righteousness throughout her life, that dying and being raised with Christ, she may share in his final victory. All praise to you, eternal Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you in the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever. Amen. And what name is given this child?
Virginia Davis.
Virginia Davis, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. They're still there. They're right behind us. Would you all like to see this beautiful child? Virginia Davis. Will you pray with me? Lord God, we pray for this child. We ask you to pour your Spirit upon her. May she know your grace. May she know your love. May you raise her up to know you and your grace. May she be a disciple of Jesus Christ who makes a difference in the world. Because of what we do this day. For this prayer we ask in the name of Jesus our Lord. Amen.
Members of the household of faith, I commend to your love and care this child whom we this day recognize as a member of the family of God. Will you endeavor so to live that she may grow in the knowledge and love of God through our Savior, Jesus Christ? With God's help, we will so order our lives after the example of Christ, that this child, surrounded by steadfast love, may be established in the faith and confirmed and strengthened in the way that leads to life eternal.
Child of blessing, child of promise, baptized with the Spirit's sign, with this water God has sealed you unto love and grace divine.
This time we'd like to invite our children to come forward. If any are here, would you all like to come on up? Would you like to come up and sit with me for a while? We're going to tell a story up here, and you can be right up here with your parents, right in front of you. We have a few more. Come on up. We got lots of room up here. We're going to tell a story here, and I think there's just a couple of minutes. We can sit up here on the steps, if you don't mind. And I want to tell you how good it is to see all of you up here, because today... You're not too sure about this, are you? Well, today we're going to tell a story about some people who have some really, really hard names, okay? So you're going to hear about it in the Bible in just a minute, but I'm going to tell you the names and then see if you can say what I say, okay? The first one is a king whose name is, this is hard, Nebuchadnezzar. Can you all say that? Come on, you got that, Nebuchadnezzar. All right, this gets a little harder. All right, we have three young men whose names were Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Can you all say that? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Maybe the congregation can help us. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Come on, that's great. Meshach, isn't that a funny name? Yeah. Well, you know what? Let me tell you a story about these three boys, or they were young men. They were in a place called Babylon, and this king, whose name was Nebuchadnezzar, you know what he did? He built a statue that was 90 feet tall, and he said, every time music plays, everybody has to bow down and worship the statue. Now, you know, that's kind of different, and all these three boys, they were trained that you're not supposed to do that when you believe in God, so you know what? They wouldn't do it. But you know what happened is that King Nebuchadnezzar was not happy about that. So he got upset, and he had this furnace. That's the place where you melt metal. It's really hot. He heated it up 7 times hotter than usual. And then he threw them into the furnace because they didn't do what he wanted them to do. Well, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they said, we're not going to do that, and that's why they were there. But you know what happened when they got in that furnace? The king looked into the door of the furnace, and he said, I put 3 people in there. How come I see 4? There was a 4th person walking with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And you know what that 4th person did? He protected them. And so they came out of the furnace. They were fine. They hadn't been hurt because the 4th man was there with them in the fire. Now, what we know about now is that that 4th person, that 4th man, did exactly what Jesus does for you and me. Here's a reminder that sometimes when we're trying to do the right thing and it doesn't feel like we're doing the right thing and people are making fun of us and they're not helping us and they tell us how wrong we are, we always remember that Jesus gave us a promise that just like he was there with those three boys in the fire, so will he be with us. Can you all remember that always? And we're going to say, put our hands together, we're going to say a prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you that you protect us, you watch over us, and you love us. Surround us as we always try to obey you and hold on to you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, y'all can go on back and have a seat. And really appreciate you being here. You can come on. You got it. Great job.
Please turn in your bulletins to the prayer for illumination and join me as we pray together. O Lord, your word is a lamp to our feet, a light to our path. Give us grace to receive your truth in faith and love, and strength to follow on the path you set before us. Through Jesus Christ. Amen. Our first reading comes from the book of Daniel, chapter 3, verses 14 through 23. Hear now the word of God. Nebuchadnezzar said to them, "Is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods, and you do not worship the golden statue that I have set up? Now if you are ready, when you hear the sound of the horn, the pipe, the lyre, the trigon, the harp, the drum, and the entire musical ensemble, to fall down and to worship the statue that I have made, well and good. But if you do not worship, you shall immediately be thrown into a furnace of blazing fire. And who is the God that will deliver you out of my hands?" Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered the king, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to present a defense to you in this matter. If our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us from the furnace of blazing fire and out of your hand, O king, let them deliver us. But if not, be it known to you, O king, that you will not serve your, we will not serve your gods, and we will not worship the golden statue that you have set up." Then Nebuchadnezzar was so filled with rage against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego that his face was distorted. He ordered the furnace heated up 7 times more than usual, and ordered some of the strongest guards in the army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and to throw them into the furnace of blazing fire. So the men were bound, still wearing their tunics, their trousers, their hats, and their garments, and they were thrown into the furnace of blazing fire. Because the king's command was urgent and the furnace was so overheated, the raging flames killed the men who lifted Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. But the three men, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, fell down, bound, into the furnace of blazing fire. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Second reading for the morning continues in these verses in the book of Daniel, continuing with the 24th verse. Listen now for the word of God. Then King Nebuchadnezzar leapt to his feet in amazement and asked his advisors, "Weren't there three men that we tied up and threw into the fire?" They replied, "Certainly, your majesty." He said, "Look, I see four men walking around in the fire, unbound and unharmed, and the fourth looks like a son of the gods." Nebuchadnezzar then approached the opening of the blazing furnace and shouted, "Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out, come here." So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came out of the fire, and the satraps, prefects, governors, and royal advisors crowded around them. They saw that the fire had not harmed their bodies, nor was a hair of their heads singed. Their robes were not scorched, and there was no smell of fire on them. Then Nebuchadnezzar said, "Praise be to the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and rescued his servants." They trusted him and defied the king's command. and were willing to give up their lives rather than serve or worship any god except their own. Therefore, I decree that the people of any nation or language who say anything against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego be cut into pieces and their houses be turned into piles of rubble. For no other God can save in this way. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Lord, as your word is offered and proclaimed on this beautiful morning, enable us to remember the power of the faith which we so often take for granted. Equip us like these three men to abide in you and hold fast to you, the fourth man in the fire, for we ask it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Several years ago, author and speaker Chuck Colson told a story about the relatively well-known Battle of Dunkirk in World War II. If you remember some of that history, all of the British, some French, but all the Allies were backed into the beach. 338,000 soldiers there, and the Germans had been surrounded and were advancing. They were trapped with seemingly no hope for escape. Well, if you know the story, the British sent a private armada of little boats across the English Channel and rescued all of those soldiers over a period of 11 days. Well, during those 11 days, it was not always sure that these soldiers would be rescued, and across the English Channel came a radio signal from the beaches of Dunkirk. And that radio signal simply had three words in Morse code. It said, "And if not." And if not. Now, in this day and age, we have lost much of our biblical literacy. But back then, the line was well understood. Indeed, it was taken, literally, from our text for the morning from the book of Daniel. As these three young men faced down a powerful king. Did you hear this verse? They said, "If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to deliver us from it. And he will deliver us from your majesty's hand. But even if he, and if not, I should say, does not, we want you to know, your majesty, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold that you have set up." You know, friends, typically when we listen to this story from Daniel, our attention, our gaze, our focus, it moves to that fiery furnace heated up seven times over. But this morning, let's spend the bulk of our time on that verse, a verse which I think is probably more relevant and helpful to all of us. This line that these Jews offered from a foreign land up to a powerful king. That verse, what those young men said to the king, it is incredibly powerful when you think about it. There are startling traces of deep faith, spirituality, even theology, that find its roots in the book of Job, but continue all the way to Jesus as he is in the garden. Those three young men, they're not only standing up for their faith, they are expressing in this one verse this stark clarity, this stark trust. They recognize they may not be saved. God may or may not save them. But there is absolute confidence and trust. And they, in that moment, reflect that point where there is something more important in their lives than their lives. And that, namely, is their God and fidelity to their God. It's a remarkable statement, and it begs the question, how did they get there? How was it that they were able to voice those words? And how did they appropriate a faith that could be the source of those words? And namely, if that's the case, how can we find that same faith also? You know, we could gather and proclaim some simplistic, moralistic responses. These three men, they summoned up the courage. Perhaps they summoned up the faith. They stood firm for what they believed. They were brave. And that is certainly true. But it doesn't play out as well, because the truth is, most of us on our own are not that strong. Most of us are not that brave. But you see, the good news of the story is that there is more to the story. This isn't the first time we meet these three men and their friend Daniel. They've been working for a couple chapters. These are the ones who had that sort of infamous diet of vegetables that equipped them to be stronger and wiser than all their competitors. These are the ones who time and time again throughout the book of Daniel are talking to God. They find God's blessing, interaction with God. And the point is that when these three men arrive at this point in front of the fiery furnace, there's a whole lot of relationship with God that has occurred prior to this event. And the point is simply this, that bravery, faith, and clarity that these boys, these young men had, it didn't just happen. It was the fruit of an abiding relationship with God. You see, that's what happens. That's what happens. When you and I love the Lord our God, as Jesus said, and as the Old Testament says, with all our heart, all our mind, all our soul, all our strength. And the question remains, how do you do it? How do you and I become like that? And the challenge is that we're dealing with a little bit of apples and oranges. It's a little bit more subtle and complex today. No king is asking us to bow down before a statue. But the truth is that we still have battles to fight around fidelity to God. But the furnaces are not quite as hot. The statues are not quite as high, though they are still there. And they're not quite as shiny, though there is still some gold in them. And the music that calls us to worship those statues, those idols, it's much more subtle and perhaps soft. The point is that we can stand firm for what we believe when things are harsh and clear and complete with the sevenfold furnace. But today in our age, is it not harder, more complicated, more complex, a little bit foggier? Well, it's more challenging in some ways, but the good news is that the route to that place is still the same. You and I somehow, in this foggy age, we have to discern who we are. What is it that we love with our heart, our soul, our mind, and our strength? Who are we? What is our identity in that phrase? See, that's what the young men had. They were firmly grounded in the God they loved and served. But it doesn't just happen, especially today. This week, I've been reading through a book by Chris Bale. He is a professor of sociology at Duke University. He's recently written a book called Breaking the Social Media Prism. And he addresses this whole question of our identity and the relationship of social media. And he alludes to the fact that many books have been written around this, and a lot of books have noticed that in this day and age where social media is so prevalent, we are increasingly forming our identity through the lens of social media, or as other books have said, through the mirror of social media. We look to those things to see who we are, and indeed to define who we are, complete with likes and dislikes. And his point is that this characterization, his metaphor of a mirror, is not quite accurate. He said, what we really need to see is that social media offers us a prism through which we see ourselves and through which we see the world. And his point is that that prism doesn't wholly reflect us accurately. When we look out at the world, we hear the loudest voices and cut out the moderate middle. When we look at ourselves, sometimes those pictures of ourselves are not so accurate. And he points out that the time we spend on social media, which is an average of 2.5 hours a day for adults in America by broadband survey in 2019, he points out that that's not neutral. It's not just entertainment. We continue to form our identity as we scan our phones. Well, friends, the point of the morning is not to battle social media. It's here, and it's here to stay. And there are some redeeming features and good features to it, certainly. But the point is that it's not going to accomplish the caliber of courage and faith and character and identity that we see in the young men of this story. But it is time to be reminded of what the Church of Jesus Christ does, and does very well, when we are at our best. You see, if we are doing our job right, God is using us and using this time to form you and to form me and place our identity first and foremost in the person of Jesus Christ, teaching us the power of what happens when you love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul, all your strength. As an example, let me tell you a story this past week. We had the privilege of joining together with our children and our youth and some adults in kids camp, something we do every year here at Reveille. We had several of our elementary age school kids participating in sites all through Richmond. I had the privilege of joining with them on Monday, one team, Monday at Shalom Farms. That's a farm we support here that provides food for the homeless and others in need in the Richmond area. And I loved it because we sat there, we had the privilege of harvesting potatoes. So the way, I never done this before, the way you harvest potatoes is you sit across from somebody else in a furrow that's been dug to loosen the potatoes, and you sit, 3 feet away from somebody, and you're just pulling potatoes out of the ground and sorting them. It's a great opportunity for conversation. And I got to do that with several folks all morning, but what I loved most was the conversation behind me in the furrow behind me. You have no choice but to overhear because you're only 4 feet away. But it was two of our elementary school boys, along with one of our seniors, our youth seniors, who's a rising senior in high school. And these three talked about baseball for hours. Just talked about stuff I never even thought about. They just went on and talked and talked, conversation I could have never held. But how wonderful it was to see that conversation between some elementary school boys and a senior, who just a vivid conversation. But that's not all they talked about. We got back here and we gathered in the picnic shelter. We talked about the importance of justice and kindness and walking humbly with our God. We had a chance to visit with the folks from Shalom Farms, which reminded us of the struggles of the homeless and others in the city of Richmond. You see what we do? See what we did in just a couple hours in the morning? You and I are in the business of forming an identity based on a true picture of God. God's love for the poor. God's love for those children. God's love for us. We get a true picture of ourselves as folks who are created in the image of God. Today we have just shared in the sacrament of baptism, and we pledge together as a church and as parents that we will seek to enable this child to know Jesus as Lord, to put her faith in Him, her identity in Him. You see, our prayer is that our children in our midst would take hold of that identity, be formed in the person of Jesus, and prayerfully never have to, but if need be, need to be equipped to do what these three men did at the furnace. And see, friends, it's just what we do. And we do it so much better than social media. We do it more accurately. We just will not abide somebody building their precious, created in the image of God, worth on the number of dislikes or likes you receive. We just don't abide forming a worldview based on who has the loudest voice. We don't abide that. We teach our children and our adults to pay attention to the constant, still, small voice of God. You see, we just don't do it. We don't base our identity, our worldview, our self-understanding on a prism. Instead, we understand and look into the face of the love of God that comes to us in Jesus Christ, and we are raised up as vessels of this grace, equipped to minister and serve in this world. That's what we do. You know what? In just a few weeks, we're going to be returning back to our Sunday morning routine. We're going to have our three morning services. Our Sunday schools are going to be fully in person. We're going to do a whole bunch of new things on Sunday nights. You're going to hear a whole lot more about that in the weeks to come. But let me, in this context, express how important it is for us to be here. Because of what we do in this day and age. How important it is to be in places of discipleship. How important it is to be at those music rehearsals and gatherings. But in all this, let us not forget the most important part of constructing this world-changing identity of which we speak. Whenever furnaces come, brothers and sisters, we meet somebody there, the one whom Nebuchadnezzar described as the fourth man in the fire. And there's a critical reminder. In the end, this identity of which we speak, it's not just about me or you or who we are. It's who we are when we meet Jesus. It's who we are in the person of Jesus Christ. It's who we are when we meet the Lord of all the universe who says, I've called you by name, you are mine, come to me all who labor and heavy are laden, and I will give you rest. And the risen Lord of all the universe says, abide in me and I'll abide in you, because apart from me you can do nothing. Do you hear the grace that is ours? That no matter what comes our way, there's a fourth man in the fire. He may refine us, but he's going to make us better, and he's going to raise us up to be a living testimony of the love for which this world searches so desperately. Hold on to that as we abide in the fourth man in the fire, and as he refines us. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
One way we are formed in the faith is through prayer. So let us come together and offer prayers on behalf of the church and the world. Let us pray. Generous God, we are thankful for all that you have done and all that you continue to do for us each day. We give you thanks for people of faith all over the world. Especially today, we lift up those who teach the faith and those who, by their example, show your steadfast love to all the world. We pray for the strength to walk in your ways and to honor you in all that we do, each and every day. We thank you for the earth and its riches, for soil and wetlands, trees, bushes, rivers and lakes, oceans and air, and for the diversity of people who inhabit your great creation. Today we lift up those experiencing natural disasters, floods, fires, and extreme heat. We pray for those who are suffering, for those who are helping, and for all of us that we might be better able to minister to their needs. We pray for the Church Universal, for our denomination, for our bishop, for our partner churches, Love Center of Unity and Koinonia Christian Church, and for our congregation. We pray for those who worship in person each week and for those who join us remotely. Bind all of us together. Help us to grow in our faith and our love and our witness. We thank you for the gift of baptism and pray that you will watch over and bless Virginia and enable us to nurture her faith and support her family as they seek to be your faithful disciples. We pray for those concerns we have lifted up out loud today and for those we name silently now in our hearts. We ask all this through your Son, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Friends, we come now to the time of our service where we participate in worship by the continuing giving of our tithes and our offerings. We will not be receiving the offering through ushers or through plates as usual here, but there is an opportunity for you to give on your way out. And as we do that, let me just remind you of the power of your generosity. Because you all are so incredible and you give so in such wondrous ways, we were able to do some really amazing things with our children this week at Kids Camp. I referenced those in the sermon. But sometimes we forget that occurs because you all give, and give so well. So hear my word of thanks for all that you do as we commit our offerings to God through a word of prayer. Lord God, we are thankful that we are able to do so many important things to form faith in our children, youth, and adults. It happens because people give so wonderfully. Thank you for these gifts, and enable us as your church to be means of multiplication for your kingdom and your glory, as we commit them to you through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Friends, our final hymn is number 127, Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah. We invite you to stand as we sing, and I remind you again to put on your mask.
Amen.
Friends, as you go now to face the joys and the challenges that are waiting for you on Monday morning, I encourage and invite you to remember that which we have heard this day. No matter what, there is a fourth man in the fire who goes with you, will be with you, and to give us all the power to do that which we cannot do on our own. Hold on to that as we go now in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, as all God's people say. Amen.